All right, welcome to the corner booth. This is really exciting. First of all, I loved your movie.
Thank you.
It's good to know.
Fernando Meirelles and Anthony McCarten, the screenwriter.
You think you know better?
I'm Argentinian. How does an Argentinian kill himself? He climbs to the top of his ego and jumps off.
You met him briefly.
No, it's just a shook.
A handshake.
Did you feel something when you met him?
I told him, I mean, I tried to tell him that I was making a film on him. He really couldn't care less. He just ignored me.
Had he seen any of your films?
It's a film. It's a big film. It's just Anthony Hopkins. And he said, oh, nice, nice. And went.
Speaking English is exhausting.
So how did this happen?
I had this idea for a story. It had come to me when I was in Rome. It was in St. Peter's Square, and Francis was giving an open-air mass. In 2013, Benedict shattered a 700-year-old tradition by resigning.
I'm going to resign.
Resign from what?
Probably the most traditional pope of the modern era. Why would he do the most untraditional thing and resign?
No, it's shocking. I remember when it happened. That was a huge
Popes
moment.
Don't resign. I mean, that's one of the defining aspects of a pope. They have to die on the job.
Forgive me, but...
Where did you shoot all the stuff in the Vatican?
So our main set was the Sistine Chapel. So we built a Sistine Chapel, a replica, perfect replica in Cinecittà.
In Cinecittà?
Yeah. And it was an amazing set. It really looks like the textures, everything.
5 centimeters bigger than the real
center. It's bigger, yes. The biggest Sistine Chapel in the world.
If I was Pope, I'd be in here every day.
Ah, what else?
What?
Going into this, what was your desire for audiences and for you writing this and this story? Did you want to change minds about something, or did you want to open minds?
Not really.
Was there an intention?
Not really. You really just follow your own fascinations and curiosity, and that's all I've done in my career is just I enter projects that I'm curious to know more about. What interested me fundamentally about these two men is that they're very different people.
So what matters is what you believe, but not what the church has taught for hundreds of years.
No.
One falls very firmly into a conservative camp, and one is firmly in a progressive camp.
The way you live is a criticism. Your shoes are a criticism.
You don't like my shoes?
We know from their stated positions that they're diametrically opposed on almost everything. To put them into dialogue seemed to be, therefore, offer the potential, at least, to speak to the conversation that's happening at large in the world. Do we want a monolith that we all respect because it doesn't change? Mm-hmm. Or actually, do we need to be dynamic? Do we need to embrace the idea of change and with all its inherent dangers? Because there's so much uncertainty with change. That dialectic, if you like, is at the heart of the story.
You think the church is failing?
We are losing people.
And that is the fault of the church, not of Western relativism or permissiveness. Or what do they say now? Oh, yes, anything goes.
There's something very interesting because we don't like to hear the people with whom we disagree. And the film is about trying and learning how to listen to the other one.
I don't agree with any about most of the things you say, think, or do, but now I can see it.
I don't agree with you, but I could be wrong. And allowing that you could be wrong is
brilliant.
The quality we need in leaders to think that they may possibly be wrong and be open.
I love the pizza scene.
Thank you, Lord, for this food that we enjoy here, in this place outside of time.
Amen.
Amen. It's good.
The idea that those two popes are going to and having a Fanta.
Popes have to eat, too.
Yeah. I just love that, because you don't think about that.
Well, the Fanta thing's 100% true. The Fanta detail came from the fact that during World War II, Coca-Cola was banned.
Yeah.
Fanta was allowed. And he loved it as a child and still drinks Fanta.
Do you have a favorite shot in the film?
No, I like very much the two of them seated against the walls of the Sistine Chapel.
My favorite, I think, is when the young Francis, he's on his way to propose because he was in love with a woman at the time, and then he received a call to be a priest, and he goes into this big empty church. He saw a priest move in the far, far distance towards a confessional box, and he goes in. And that dying priest that was there that day was the instrument of the calling of this young man with flowers in his hand who was about to get married.
Pero no vino nadie. I
hasta que llegaste vos.
So, one last question for both of you.
Sure.
For you, how did you know you were going to be a writer?
I didn't really. I fell into it. I just desperately wanted to escape high school. And there was an announcement in class one day that anyone interested in a career in journalism should line up outside the science lab. And I became a journalist and started to write and just fell in love with words.
And do you have any stories that you go back to that are unfinished?
Leadership seems to keep coming up. And I'm not quite sure why I keep examining leadership.
That is the calculation of leadership, a calculation we must both make.
Maybe because we're so dependent on good leadership and we're so in want of it now.
And what about you, Fernando? Is it something,
was there a moment? I was trained as an architect. And then I had to create my thesis, graduation thesis, instead of a project or a monography, I decided to make a video. So I bought equipment to shoot my video. I don't know why I decided to do it. I liked cinema. So I kept doing a lot of video art, and I had a group of friends that we started working together, and this became a little production company. Coming out of the school, I was just accidentally became a filmmaker.
I love this movie, and I'm really happy to meet you both.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
For coming by.
Very good. Thank you.